Hello, in this part I would like to work with queues, so it will be the basic example how to create a simple queue with a single receiver and a single sender. We will start from STM32 cube IDE. So I've got some ready workspace in front of me. I will start a new project, so I go to File, New, STM32 project. Just to remind you, in this training we are working with STM32L476RG microcontroller, which is soldered on Nucleo L476RG board. So I selected this one, click Next. My project name would be 2_Qs_basic. Then I would click just finish. Okay, finally we've got pinout of our microcontroller. Just to save the time, you can reuse any of exercises from different section. What we will do within this one, what we will need. First, within system core and sys, I would select debug as trace asynchronous SW, just to have SWD plus single wire output, which is used to communicate some simple commands from tasks and interrupts within our code. Then I need to change the time-based source used by HAL library from default SysTick to, for example, timer 6. It is due to the fact that SysTick is used already by the operating system. Then within this we will do not need any other hardware resources. We keep the clock configuration on default settings, so MSI 4 MHz without any PLL. So we can go to middlewares, and here we select FreeRTOS, and within this we select interface, so API in version 2, so CMSys v2, and within its configuration we'll keep at the moment default settings and the default includes, and let's go to tasks and queues. There is already some default task defined over here, so I would rename it to our new task, which would be a sender one. I can do it by double click on its name. A priority normal will keep the same as stack size 256, just to be sure that it would be enough memory for our operations. And then the entry function will be start sender one. Then OK. And let's add one more task. So I go again to tasks and queues. I click add. And this time it would be receiver, priority again normal, stack size 256, and the name of the function start receiver. Okay, next point would be to create a queue, so I click on within this queue area on add. Let's change this default name into Q1. Number of components within the queue we will define to 8, limit to 8. And item size we will use 8-bit values without sign, so unsigned int 8. So in our queue we are planning to have maximum 8 components of 8-bit each. I create OK. So now I can see two tasks and one queue as operating system components. So that's it for the configuration of our system. I can generate the code using, for example, this device configuration tool button. So it will take some time. We expecting to change the perspective to C++. If not, I can just manually switch to main.c file. Within main.c file, I can see within the private variables part initialization the declaration of OS components, so both tasks, sender 1 and receiver, and queue. As you can see, there is as well the definition of attributes of each component, and within those attributes, usually we are defining only the names. Within tasks as well, priority and stack size. The rest of the attributes, so the pointers to the memory structures, are generated and filled automatically during the creation of those components. If we go below, within main function, we can see the hardware initialization of the complete system, so hal init, system clock config, our peripherals, so where we need, we used only GPIOs. Then there is initialization of kernel, so usually it is the heap initialization, especially in heap 4 and heap 5 models. After this, there is a creation of OS components, which we define to the MX part, so we create a queue, and then both tasks. Then there is a kernel start, and while one loop, where we should never, let's say, reach this line. Let's go to our task entry functions. So our first function is a code for the sender. So it is called start sender1. Within this function, we will add some local variable. So it will be 8-bit x initialized to 0. And then within, let's say, the endless loop, we will first send some sign of life. I'm using some universal function. It is called task action. You can define within any action, so it can send data over UART, send data over ITM interface. In this particular example, as in others within this training, we will use ITM data send. As within STM32 Cube IDE, it is possible to put single wire output on data console. It is quite efficient way to have some additional debug interface. And as you remember, within CubeMX part, we have selected as well SWO as an active pin within our debug interface. Okay, we'll come back to this task action a bit later on. Let's focus now on, let's say, the implementation of our sender task code. So, sign of life, it is the first one, first line. The second line, it will be sending some data into the queue. So, OS message control space. Message put. Then we've got only one queue, so I select this one. Then there is a message pointer. So in our case, it will be this X variable, its address. Then priority. We are not using this, so I put a 0. And the timeout. So how much time I would like to try to send data over into the queue? I would put 200 milliseconds. After this, I would increase my variable just to be sure that the code is executed properly. So it should send the data from 0 to 9 and then from 0 again. After these, those operations, I would like to send my task, my sender task, into blocked state for 1 second. So it will be the implementation of sender. And then let's implement our receiver task function body. So it is just below. So here we will define as well some local variable. It will be as well 8-bit without any sign. And it will be some data taken from the queue. I would define it as 0 at the beginning. Then I would start as well from sign of life, task action, and it will be big R. After this, I will try to get some data from the queue as message queue get. And then again we've got Q handle, and we need to define, let's say, our variable where we would like to store the data from the queue. Then the priority, we are not using this, and the timeout, so how long we'll wait for the data, I would put 2 seconds. After this, I will display what I just received, so it will be data plus 48. As I would send to the queue only digits from 0 to 9, I add this 48 to have the ASCII codes of the digits. We will not use any delay for this task, so it should try to get data from the queue. And of course, in case of missing information in the queue, it will be in a blocked state for maximum 2 seconds waiting for the data. So it would be the result. Now it is a time to define our task action function. So I would use for this user code begin for. Okay, so this is only the skeleton, and now we will fill the data inside. Okay, so let's come back to our task action just to be in line with our materials. I want to use exactly the same namings, and within our code we would use two instructions. So it will be ITM send char, so instrumentation trace macro cell send char, so single character. Then I would send this one character, and then just to start new message in a new line, I would use the sign of new line. That's it. Just to be compliant with C, I put the declaration on top in a user code private function prototypes part, and I will try to build the code using the hammer. My board is already connected. Okay. So I start a debug session. I will just check whether everything is enabled. So I need a serial wire viewer. My clock is 4 MHz, not 16, so I need to change it. And I press apply and OK. I will reconnect my board. OK, let's start our debug session. So I click on this bug icon. Okay, now I need to run my SWV ITM data console. For those of you who started with this part already, you can find it within this quick access by SWV, and then this data console is this ITM data console. Okay, we need to configure it first. So to enable this pin 0, port 0, as we are using single wire for the trace. Before running the application, I need to start tracing, so I press start trace, and then I start my application. I can see something is coming, I will pause it, suspend the application, the execution, and what I can see? I can see that the beginning was a receiver, and then it was stopped, because it was waiting for data for the queue from the queue. Then sender was selected by the scheduler, this is why I can see this big S over here. And then sender sends this 0, so the first character, first digit into the queue, and it went to blocked state for 1 second. After this, receiver has been selected by the scheduler. This is why I can see first 0 and then receiver. It is due to the fact that if we come back to our code and we have a look on the receiver, so our receiver executed first this line, then it was blocked on this waiting for data, and once sender sent this data to the queue, it has been unblocked and it was possible for this receiver to execute this line. This is why we can see at this as a third line this zero. After this, as we do not see any delay here, there is a second iteration of this loop. This is why we can see the as a fourth element the R receiver. Then receiver is waiting for next data in the queue. This is why it is in blocked state. So in the meantime, scheduler is selecting the sender. So sender appears here. This is his. It's let's say sign of life. And after this, again we can see first the digit. So this is one, and then R, which is over here. And story continues. So this is how it is behaving. Now we will try to make this this application a bit robust, because we would like to be sure whether it was possible for us to get any data from the queue. Please have a look that within this function, this OS message queue get, we are specifying the timeout given in milliseconds. And this function can go, let's say can pass with success of getting data from the queue. In this case, we can see something within this variable RES, but it can return with error message. Error message, which can be, for example, timeout. So it would mean that it was not possible to get any data from the queue within this specified 2000 milliseconds timeout. And in our next step, we will check what was the reason of passing into the line 266. So for the moment, I would terminate the debug session and I would come back to code processing. Within this part, we will have a closer look on this return value of OS message queue get. As I told you, in the theoretical part, it is OS status _T. Very popular type within CMC's OS API, and it is quite important to have a look on this return value, especially if we are waiting for some OS components like queues, semaphores, or mutexes. So in this case, we will check whether this OS message queue get function returns correctly with a status 0, so OS OK, or it returns due to some issues, for example, with too short timeout, which is 2000 milliseconds in this case. So I would like to check this R state. This R state in our materials is defined within this as a local variable, but I would like to monitor this within my debugger. This is why it would be better to put it in as a global. So I go to this user code begin private variables part. This is my R state and it should be OS status _T type. Okay, so we've got this. I will build a code. Start a debug session. And I will try to add this R state to live variables. Now here on the right side, I can see the tab live expressions. I can add my R state over here, R_state, and enter. At the moment, we can see OS OK. OS OK means zero, as you remember from our access from our theoretical part. If I would use as well this SWV ITM data console, I would start it and run. I can see this is still OS OK, so it seems it is working correctly. So let's do an experiment, and within our experiment, I would decrease this timeout to 200 milliseconds. And rebuild the code. Start the debug session. Okay, I would put this console live variables and let's start tracing and run application. Oh, you see, it is executing from time to time. as OS error timeout, and we can see that receiver. What we can see on the screen, I pause it for a moment. You can see that we can see some the same values in the row. It is due to the fact that if we do not receive anything new within this REC value, we'll have the same like on previous iteration of this loop. So this is why we can see few times in a row, nines, eights, etc. But what is important is this status. As we observed, we can see OS OK or OS timeout. OS timeout is a negative value, which means that this timeout was too short to successfully get any data from the queue. This is why it is important to check really what is the return value of this function to be sure that we have something new from the queue and we are not working on some, let's say, previous content. Okay, the solution here could be as well to put OS wait forever, and in this case we will wait for the data in the queue till we will have them. So it will be no other option to come back from this blocked state. Let's say from the only way to come back from this blocked state in this case would be to get any data in the queue. But in case we would like to use some timeouts, it is good to check the return value of the function which is given by this OS message QGET. So that's all for this basic exercise concerning queues. In the next exercises, we will focus on two topics. The first one would be two senders and one receiver, and next one would be how to handle more complex data using queues. So thank you for your attention.